Hey all.
It is Scotty, S3 Model Works. Good evening, welcome. Hope this finds you and your families all well and good. Gearing up to do part 3, Painting with Uncle Scotty. We're going to do a little bit of work on my Bf-109. Hopefully blend in the bottom and playing. So, anyway, tonight I have a new setup. I'm working with my camcorder and wearing earbuds. I'm doing some testing. That's what this video is about tonight. So bear with me while I muddle through, once again, one of my YouTube videos. Okay, y'all. I'm back. This is my main table view. If you see the little yellow dots up here, those are basically just tracking lines for me so I can try to keep it in frame the best I can. Over here on my whatever side that is, it's my right side probably appearing on your left. I'll zoom in for you in a minute, but the liquid masking that I did, basically what I'm trying to do is separate and protect areas of the wing root. Specifically, you'll see it when I zoom in here, but there's a little dihedral that's pretty much right up here in line with just about where the canopy front shield slides back from the main canopy, that I wanted to separate. And again, I'm just trying to keep overspray off of that root, because that's the area that's going to have the modeling down here, and then it's out here farther on the wing is where I'm going to have the harder mask stuff. Here in front of the camera is a couple of palettes that I sprayed basically on white cardstock. I didn't even prime them, I just wanted to see what the colors look like. The two yellow strips are just representative of the Gelb or the RLM04 color that I'm going to spray. That's an enamel, and that's with the wing tips. And there's a waistband on it between the main wings and the horizontal stabs that's also going to be yellow, as well as part of under the nose. So that's the yellow I'm going to be using. This is a little bit of the RLM76, also an enamel, that I pushed in some of the highlights on the bottom. We did that pretty much in Painting with Uncle Scotty Part 1 and 2. The RLM74 that says Graugrun or Grey Green is a color that's going to be part of the modeling, if I'm not mistaken. The RLM2 I sprayed, and that's just a basic gray. It's also an enamel. Everything on this side is an enamel. Everything over here is an acrylic, with the exception of the yellow down here. I'm not sure if I'm going to integrate that or not, but that's, I believe, is also a color that's called out that's going to be on the fuselage. So moving on to the acrylics, this is RLM66, which is basically a black gray. I did some solid spraying here, and then as you can see, I also did some modeling on all of these, because I wanted to see how it sprayed and how they came out. So next we've got RLM70, and that is black green. So black gray, black green for the RLM70, and the last color is RLM75, which is a gray violet. That's a really neat color, and as an acrylic, that sprays really well. So anyway, there's my paint palettes. And I just keep those for reference. So let me show you guys a little bit about what I meant. And we'll give the camera just a second to focus here, and let me get it all in frame. Up here in the top, and I know it's more difficult to see, so let me hold it up a little bit. The area that I'm working in, that I'm trying to improve tonight, is basically everything right in here. So you can see a little bit of the light blue that's going to be on the underside of the wings, and honestly, the way the color callouts are, it basically does go all the way right up here to the canopy line. So that's the area that I was trying to protect on the wing roots up there, and that's what I'm going to be trying to improve. And that's my overall base color, and again, that was sprayed with the model air, the pale blue-gray 71046 again. And I'm going to be reinforcing when we finally get through with the mass, I'm going to be reinforcing that and making my custom mix with a little bit of the light blue, the RLM78. But these are some of the patterns that I was talking about, and you guys may be able to make this out specifically on most of this wing that's showing right here, as I have another cut out here that actually shows both wings. But this is that little ripple pattern that I was telling you that bleeds over the top of the leading edge right here. And then in addition, you can see how this is the normal RLM Luftwaffe markings and the colors appropriate for the time and period. And this particular plane was Albuquerque, Finland, 1943, flown by Hauptmann Heinrich Erler. And he was in over 200 confirmed kills ace in the war, and he lost his life against B-24 Liberators last year of the war. Okay, I'm back. I forgot a couple things, so I'm just going to lay them in. I wanted a couple of more reference points on the flaps and the wing root. So, just going to lay those in real quick and real briefly. Eek! Made a mistake. That's alright. That'll be okay. And let me see, anything on the back I want to get? Yep. Want all of that. And as you guys can see, I'm really just sketching, more or less. Okay. So anyway, there's the finished product, and let's start cutting. That would not be good. All right, so tail pretty much in the trash. And nose in the trash. And who is that? Oh, that's Gary Hoey. Song called Pihai. He's a real good guitarist. So as you guys can see, the only thing I left are the wings, right? And that's roughly how my mask are going to lay out. And as you can see, looks like I scaled them fairly well. All I got to do now is work on trimming them up. I just had a thought, but I'll share it with you guys after the song's over. Might be a neat opportunity for me and for you guys to see just how well that liquid mask works, because after playing with this tracing paper, I think it's going to be a little stiff to work with around the wings, and I'm not sure. I don't want to scratch my base coat, so I might just mask it up for you real quick and you guys can see for yourselves. Actually, I think I'll do that. That'd be a great opportunity to show you guys just how well that stuff works as soon as I get it laid out. Shouldn't be too long here. I have a ton up space on my... Hey all, it's Scotty, I'm back. I'm still kind of in break mode, so I thought I'd give you guys a quick video tour of my workbench. This is, I paint on both of my tables, both the larger table and this one, but I try to keep most of my painting over here. So let me just take you through what I got. Basically, it's an Iwata BCS 0.5 Eclipse brush. It's a good brush. It's almost 18 years old. So I got a little bit of storage container over here. There's my music, my little Ark of a Diver mannequin man. Got a lot of my acrylic Vallejo paints, my motorcycle sitting over there in the corner. Got a bunch of tools in here. Several sets of tweezers, scriber tool, some other things in there. All my sanding equipment, different types, styles, grits. Some metal files, a little burnishing thing, my good sets of nippers that are in there, a couple pair of hemostats. Those are invaluable. My very messy electrical cords. Sorry about this one hanging in the way. That's my Iwata Sprint Jet. That is a tankless compressor. I like it. I have another credenza over here. Let me see if I can keep this cord out of the way for us. Come on, Scott. Focus. So, drawer number one, which is on the bottom. Just got a lot of ancillary stuff in there. Headlamp, which is one reason why I'm really looking forward to my new magnifiers. Rags, tools. I keep all my glues, thinners, and stuff down here just because they're out of the way. They're off the bench. I only keep on the bench what I'm using. So drawer number two. My paint storage is a neat idea that I stole from Paul Budzik. And basically it's just some L-angle flashing, like roof flashing, that's put in there. I cut it to the width of the drawer and put it in there and taped one side of it. And looky, Scotty found a bunch of cookies. Let me turn my light on so you guys might get a little bit of a better look. Sorry. Come on, light. So basically, I keep a good blend of, I got a mix of acrylics, enamels, and lacquers. Most of my lacquers and my nasty stuff are in the back. I have another drawer basically full of all my Tamiya's extra gloves. I got panel liner back there. I got some Mr. Hobby metal blends. Different stuff like that. And then we'll look at my drawer. As you guys can see, I am anal retentive to a T. So, sprue goo, cotton buds, razor saws, toothpicks, utility brushes, airbrush cleaning equipment, some ancillary stuff, toothbrush for cleaning things out, a couple little paint pot trays, my sharp stuff, markers, cutting, drilling, baking soda, masking tape in the back. Now, I actually have some counter space now. I used to have a 46-inch TV sitting up there on the counter. Great for sitting out here watching movies, playing music, doing whatever I wanted. But I gotta be honest with you, it was too big. It was eating up my cabinet space. I couldn't get into those cabinets back there. Little Xbox over there in the corner. I put a much smaller TV down there, which was a really neat gift from my niece. She ended up getting a new one and gave me her old one. That's just a screensaver program playing in the back over there. And let's see if I got enough electrical cord to get us closer over there. Over there in the corner, I got a couple of models set up. Those were a couple that I built. They're both Airfix kits. The one in the back is a 1/72 scale AV-8A. That's one of the very first Harriers, and I think that particular scheme is a Marine Corps scheme out of Osaka, Japan, about the year of the U.S. Bicentennial, 1976. The other one is a World War II version of a Bedford MWD, which is a rough equivalent of a, of an American airfield utility truck straight out of World War II. So before I get turned around on my cords and get us tangled up again, we'll take a final look at my chair. That was a real nice gift from my sister. That's an all-steel chair. I don't mean as in made all steel. It's made by a company called All Steel here in America. High quality business chair. Very, very comfortable. And as you can see, I'm wearing that butt seat out really, really well. So a little turntable that my very good and longtime friend Kathy had sent me about two and a half years ago, huh, Kath? Really neat. She saw that when I returned to modeling after so many years absence that I was really struggling to kind of display my models and stuff. So she had sent me that, which has been a wonderful gift. Right now it's just acting as a utility table, Kath. I promise I'll put it to better use. And there's just a quick peek at my stash. You can see I have a lot of aircraft down there. Some World War I, some World War II, some modern. Got some tanks up there. And then over here this is actually an air conditioning unit. And don't tell my sister, but I rewired it. It actually has a fan function on it. And I managed to reverse the motor in there and put an auxiliary backward spinning blade in there. And when I turn on the fan function, it acts like a mini extractor. It is not a dedicated extractor. I don't spray into it. But as I pan around the garage, you guys can see, give or take, I got about 400-ish square feet in here. That thing moves 400 cubic feet a minute. So by the time you do the math on the ceiling height in here, I'm getting a completely circulated room in here, even spraying without a respirator or a mask, about every 4 minutes. For the vast majority of my work, I use acrylics. When I am painting with lacquers specifically, I mask up, and I usually don't film when I'm spraying with acrylics. Sometimes I'll do it with enamels, and the only reason I do it with enamels is because enamel, being paint thinner, it's heavier than air. It tends to stick to the floor, and I have a couple of auxiliary ways to get air in here. I used to be an old truck captain, so I know how to ventilate a structure. So I use the garage door basically faces southwest, and I use a lot of natural wind in here that comes in here, gets sucked in through the machine, right up and out where the towel's covering it up there. So anyway, that's S3 Modelworks introduction to his bench. And there's my arc of a diver. Okay, I'll be back with you guys in a little bit, and we'll finish masking and hopefully start painting. Hang tough. Okay, I'm back. New camera angle, and I'll do a little zoom check here just to kind of see what's going on and see if I place anything out of place. And if I'm not mistaken, yeah, that's my wing. You can see it right there on the leading edge. That little glint right there where I taped. Right. Oop, a little too far. Yeah, but anyway, you can see it. So, I'll probably be painting it, give or take. I'll see if I can give you guys a decent view. I am going to have to face this thing. You know what? I might be able to paint it this way. Let's see something real quick, just for fun. Or as Austin Powers would say, for shits and giggles, baby. For grins. Yeah, you know, maybe we'll try that and see. I can probably work on the backside from there. I think. All right. I'm going to stop the vid here, mix up some paint, get ready to go, and we'll come back.